Anyway, thank you very much for coming. Basically, what you have here is a panel of people who are biting off the problem of the future of journalism from very different perspectives. So we've got people in what we might call like pure journalism and publishing on this side, the good guys. And then we've got Keith and, and we've got Keith and Mara, who are attacking the problem from the sort of advertising and media side. Also the good guys. I mean, actually, I put this panel together with Amanda because everyone here has had such an exciting position on this topic. And we're in such complicated times that it takes more than one brain to work it out. I'm going to just go for the first. Oh, in fact, let me just quickly tell you how this is going to work. So we'll do half an hour of conversation, and then I figure you guys are hungry to ask questions, right? How many of you came with questions? You're going to see? Okay, so we'll see how it goes. But hopefully, you know, one thing we like to do at Startup Socials is have any question answered. So, you know, we're not, as you can see, it's like a fairly informal event, but there's a really great opportunity to kind of clarify your thinking, and you've got amazing minds to bounce off. And also, one other thing is that we really believe that at Startup Socials that the audience are experts too. So, you know, get out there with your questions and, you know, if you've got an answer to someone else's question, put your hand up and you can answer it. So anyway, without further ado, I better have a sip because I've got chronic dry mouth right now. we'll just go straight for, you know, the neck here. And I'm looking for an answer from all of you, and this will be a way to kind of establish the kind of parameters of the conversation. How did we wind up with fake news? You know, how did we get here where we are now? And I'll start with you, Jonathan.
Well, I think what has happened over the last 15 years with eroding profits in journalism and the rise of the internet and social media and the proliferation of the ease of publishing and everybody is now a publisher has given us all a tremendous ability to voice our opinions in a way that has given platform to people that were not typically regarded as publishers, as journalists. And it's multifaceted, and we don't have enough time tonight to figure out how we got into fake news. There are so many things that have happened over the course of just the election cycle alone, which is my primary focus right now in my work for the next 4 years, potentially 8 years. And it is what it is. I still, you know, I'm hopefully gainfully employed for the duration of all of these things. And it is the brunt of my focus right now. And I think that everything right now that I am focused on is debunking fake news. But fake news arises from native advertising, branded advertising, people in Brazil who decide that they can get Google ad revenue out of writing fake news. It is people that recognize that there are opportunities to gin up completely fraudulent claims about everything that's happening in American culture right now, specifically in politics, that has eroded our ability to actually have a conversation about the facts. Alternative facts also play a role in this, and the rise of alternative facts, which is something I've never heard of before, which is very interesting. So I'm not going to take all the wind. We're with four bright people. I want a lot of people to be able to say what we're doing here.
Thank you so much. Same. I'm interested in the future of what fake news are bringing us to. So what's interesting to me is to see that the future of these facts or this fake news that we're trying to fight is storytelling, and that's what I'm interested in, and we'd like to I'd like to explore more tonight.
Is this working? Can you hear me?
No. Is that better? I think it's largely driven by technology and the law of unintended consequences. We've had a democratization of publishing technology since the first printing press was controlled by the church, and the people who ran the presses were making pornography on the presses when they weren't running on official business. And the spread of technology that empowers people to write and get their voice out, and then the business models that have changed over the last 10 or 15 years to the point now where we have technology companies distributing news and creating advertising models that allow somebody in Brazil to create fake news without having that editorial layer that we all depended on for so long. And it's a complex problem, and there's no governor overriding it, right? So we as society have to figure out a new equilibrium, and it's sort of hit a tilting point in the last couple of years, I think. But I think it's largely technology driven.
The way that I look at fake news is through this idea of, excuse me, this idea of native advertising. Does everybody know what native advertising is? That's the question. Yes. So if you don't, basically native advertising is advertising that is created to be indigenous to the site within which it exists. So whether it's Facebook or Twitter or the New York Times or the Washington Post, it looks and feels like journalism, but is in fact advertising. And so what we have is this blurring of the line between what is really news and what is not news. And what I would also argue about this is that this is not anything that is new, and it has started, I say that it started probably around the 1980s when corporations started taking over the newsrooms at the broadcast networks. And what we saw at that time was that those places were not required to be profit centers. And suddenly, after the Tishes of the world came, suddenly their international divisions were shut down. They had to find ways in order to be more profitable, and the way to do that was to get news as cheaply as possible. And one of the ways to do that is to take news from corporations. So that happened in the form of video news releases, which are like press releases that would go into a newspaper but appear on your local news instead. Same things happens in a newspaper. 50% or more of a newspaper is a press release that's taken out from a corporation and just slid right into the newspaper. Nothing about it would tell you that that is in fact something provided by a corporation.
Yep, so this is the interesting thing. So, you know, business models help potentially drive fake news, but also it's difficult to define what fake news actually is. I mean, there are people in Brazil and Macedonia who can make money out of fake news, but part of the problem is also, like, are readers interested in facts? So how do we get readers more interested in facts? Salima?
That's my favorite question, actually, because I think that people are not interested in facts. I mean, if I tell you there are 1,000 people who died in Burundi last month, I mean, you're not monsters, but you're not gonna get very much interested. So you're gonna go on with your lives, and I completely understand, because as human beings, we care about stories, we care about people, and that's what I think the future of journalism should head towards, because we are a species that values storytelling, and that's gonna stay forever. So that's what's interesting. And just actually, I have a very nice doorman who actually voted for Trump. And when I try to engage with him, when I try to engage a conversation, he's not interested in facts. He doesn't want to know that there are 94% of the terrorist attacks on American soil were conducted by non-Muslim people. He is afraid of terrorists, and that's he only wants to hear things that are going to reassure him and make him feel safer at night. So if I tell him these numbers, it's not interesting, and maybe I should engage with more storytelling with him over tea or coffee.
Right, that's interesting. So, you know, there are the facts, there are the cold, hard numbers, but actually you need to engage him in the numbers by telling this story about what it means, which actually leads to something Jonathan and I have been talking about, which is this idea of, like, helping readers think better. And you once said on a phone call that you felt that news organizations' role right now is to actually help readers just think about things better, think about the facts, put them into context.
So yeah, I think that Time specifically has a responsibility to inform readers of what's going on in the news right now and let the dust on the first draft of history settle. And I want to read something that our managing editor wrote recently in the last couple of days. And it's so prescient that the mission of Time and the mission that we as journalists have, and I think that the standards that we have to uphold have never actually been so true as they have been today. It's two short paragraphs. Our purpose is not to tell people what to think. It's to help them decide what to think about. Give them the information that they need to make up their own minds. And this is my words. Every video Time produces seeks to address this, even if in broad strokes. Back to Nancy's words. At a time when the media is ever more fractured and soiled, Time is one of the few institutions that speaks to a broad and global influence. We're most effective when we welcome debate and discussion from all compass points. Both praise and criticism of what we do comes from left, right, and points in between. And that's where we live, at the center of the conversation that must be civil, rational, and open-minded. We're committed to independent inquiry, defending the possibility of progress, holding powerful to account, and providing an arena where voices and visions compete. And I don't think that there is anything that speaks more to journalistic integrity, to those couple of sentences that really talk about what we're actually after in the era that we exist in today.
Love it. So my question to the whole panel, and I definitely want to kick this off to Keith first, is, you know, is it only journalists that can be responsible storytellers in this day and age? Or, you know, we live in social media is one way to produce stories, brands can produce stories. Keith, what do you say?
Well, brand journalism's been around roughly 10 years. And one of the realizations that we've come to is if you're going to do brand journalism, you have to think like a publisher. And that means you have to have a business model. And so, if you're going to build an audience, and I think companies, whether consumer or business to business, when they've gone to a publication, they may have a perspective or frame of reference, and they go to the publication that may be too wide or too narrow a perspective. Whereas today, to become a publisher, you have to define who your audience is and deliver value to them. And with the technology advancement and the cost curve coming down, brands can actually put themselves in business as a publisher, but they need a framework to do that. So that's where we've been coming from, is to create that framework. I'll also say that puts the responsibility on a brand that owns a publication, whether it's consumer or B2B, to have editorial integrity. So in no way am I advocating fake facts. I'm actually saying that a brand has an extra responsibility to have journalistic integrity.
Yeah, and that's the interesting thing, right? I mean, if
can I jump in on that?
I'm going to bring you in, for sure. So, you know, if brands could tell a better story, why can't they curate the facts? And I know, Mara, you're ready.
I'm ready.
Yeah,
I'm ready.
So go for it.
Keith and I should have been sitting right next to each other on the opposite ends of the panel. It's really interesting to me because the way that Keith talks about this is the same conversations that I had with people who worked for brands for about 2 or 3 years when I was doing the research for my book, Black Ops Advertising. And what people say who work on brands is that we as brands understand and know this industry better than anybody else. And it can be true to a certain extent that there may be, some of you probably know Casper, right? You've seen the sort of mint colored advertising that appears. And they have a website called Van Winkle's. And Van Winkle's doesn't say anywhere, unless you look way at the bottom of the site, that it's for Casper. And it's everything you could possibly want to know about sleeping, about Michelle Obama having the Girl Scouts over for a sleepover, all these kinds of things. Now, for that particular brand, it may not be that big an issue, but you should know there's a corporate sponsor behind the information that is being presented to you. And that's where the line for me starts to get really muddy. Is we need to know who is presenting the content to us and not simply that content is being presented to us. And where this starts to get really questionable is when we get into journalistic sites like the New York Times, like the Washington Post, like the Wall Street Journal, and all of the rest of them that are hiring former journalists who can't find work anywhere else because all the publications folded, right? We had about 10 years ago when a number of newspapers folded. Journalists are having a hard time finding jobs where they can find jobs or places where they can write what looks like journalism for brand marketers. And then it becomes content that becomes very difficult to differentiate between what's branded content and what's real journalism. If it's something like, and I'm sure a lot of you know this one, Orange is the New Black was the first piece that was done by the New York Times, the T-Brand Studio, right? Do I care that Netflix and Orange is the New Black is giving information about women in prison? No, I think that's probably information that's really interesting, probably wouldn't have been done, the Times wouldn't have touched it because they didn't have the money to produce that kind of content. But when Shell Oil is presenting content about sustainability, and it's being done under the imprimatur of the New York Times, and the same thing is true of Goldman Sachs, and they're trying to clean up their image after the recession of 2008, then we have to start questioning what, you know, where is the integrity of these particular journalistic outlets.
I'd just like to check in. I think it's incredibly important, from my experience, having built three publications, that the integrity has, first of all, it starts with saying, I'm the brand and I'm presenting this information. And that if you, one only needs to watch 15 minutes of MSNBC and 15 minutes of Fox News and realize that even the media industry has its own bias. And if the media industry is allowing a brand like Shell to advertise through native advertising on its site to get the gloss of credibility by being in the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal, then you can equally say that a brand, if they act with integrity, can publish on their own, build an audience, and instead of selling an ad, ask to have a direct conversation with a customer. And the technology exists to do that.
Yeah, I mean, personally, I think more interesting than the whole journalistic integrity question is where does the money come from to create true stories and like handle the facts? And you know, journalism has, you know, journalists, as you know, a freelance journalist like Salima, you have to pitch stories and get editors interested, and that means you're going to have to find an editor who can afford to fund the story you want to tell. And you know, whilst Casper, you know, produces Van Winkle's, actually they've created a whole niche of people who might be really interested in talking about sleep. They can hire more journalists who can kind of stay, maintain that integrity with the story. So my question is like, you know, there's a kind of element of entrepreneurship that's entering journalism anyway, through the kind of failing business models of traditional media. Salima, how do you get an editor to pay attention to you?
That's a very interesting question, because I think that in a lot of tech-related industries right now, there's this question of precarity of work and of the responsibility of the provider of the service to become an entrepreneur. And it's no different when it comes to journalism. So when you're a freelancer, you have to differentiate yourself and have a different voice and that will stand out in the noise. So you want to specialize. You want to have a strong, personality, brand, and pitch your stories. And of course, that's the job of the editor to find the money. But it's becoming harder. I mean, it's always been hard for journalists. I mean, they were not millionaires in the past, but right now the question is just different. And there are more freelancers for sure. And just to finish on that, but I have friends that are older, and I know that before they could be the primary breadwinner as a journalist and or even a good freelancer. If you're good, you could have a sustainable revenue, but it's not the case anymore. It's very, very rare.
I mean, wouldn't a really enterprising journalist right now choose a niche like 80s nostalgia and just try and own it? Because we know that all 80s nostalgia or 90, any nostalgia content plays well on social media, attracts loads of traffic. I mean, if someone like me came to you, Jonathan, and pitched you, I'll be that guy, what would you say?
If you were pitching me 80s nostalgia, I would not reply, and I would move your message to trash. I get 30 pitches a day, and they all go to the trash. It's been weird. My career started in local journalism, and I started in newspapers as a photojournalist, and I never imagined working as an editor. I mean, I'm 35 years old, and I'm working as an executive producer at Time, which is an incredible honor to lead this team of now 30 producers leading video for three titles that are now producing what's going to amount to like 8 billion video streams this year. It's insane. Like, my job has evolved to something I never imagined it being, but the garbage that comes from freelancers, and this is not, you have not pitched me. You would never pitch me. What did you say? I can't even remember. It was so bad. It was like 80s, 80s what? No, it's like move to trash. It's like not even in my like attention sphere. It's like be on the news. And the thing that we are doing is like we are reporting on important issues. And if I see things that are not in that sphere, it's immediately not even, like I can't even give it my time because my time is precious. And I know that my time is precious. And I have to do the things that actually matter and are going to make a difference to our audience and are going to make a difference for how our audience understands the world that we live in.
And I totally get that, but at Time, do you have the luxury of funding to be able to pursue the truth that kind of other people don't have? And in that sense, do you still, your money at the end of the day must curate one fact over another, or you can only pursue so many stories. So how do you choose between all of them?
So I think that how do we choose? This is editorial sensibilities. This is editorial priorities. And at the end of the day, I'm very fortunate to work for, in the 93-year history of Time Magazine, the first female editor-in-chief of our magazine, Nancy Gibbs, who I love dearly. And she is an amazing woman who has an incredible editorial sensibility and a very clean sense of what Time should and should not report on. And that covers every issue that is present in our daily conversations. And that spans politics and race and religion and all the things that we are actually talking about right now. So I think that that decision is largely deciphered by the conversations that we are having on a daily basis in our editorial meetings and saying, everybody's talking about this right now. How do we cover this story responsibly? And obviously, politics has been a huge part of our conversation at Time, and it will continue to be a huge part of our conversation at Time throughout this presidency and potentially beyond. I mean, it's always been very central to Time's coverage.
So, one recurring theme that comes up with, journalists is, and this whole discussion, in general, is like it's mission-based. So it's like it's value-centric. Like journalism defines itself in the things it adheres to. It's the means before the end type thing. So, right now, are we creating, do readers deserve better news, or do they deserve the news that they pay for? And by that, I mean, most of us are not paying for news anymore. where's that taking journalism? Keith?
Well, I think you get what you pay for. I mean, that's the bottom line. On the other hand, you have, you know, as you described Time Magazine, it's a brand, and it's built on integrity, and has a relationship with its audience. You know, it's something that really struck me this morning, it was a conversation about a headline, a story, and an editorial perspective in the Wall Street Journal. You had an editorial perspective about what's going on in the presidency. There should be a Chinese wall between what the editorial perspective is, and you have a range of voices on the editorial side, and then you have the news side. Well, you had the news with a glorious eye candy headline that said the intelligence community is not giving information to the president, and then you had a news story that had very little fact in it, and it was just a conjecture with one quote backing it up, and that one quote was really reflected from what came out of the editorial side of the house. So media companies have a responsibility to separate editorial and opinion from news and fact. And in the world in which brands are now publishers, and imagine a world where a brand like Under Armour or Starbucks has the president calling them out and other media properties calling them out, if that brand does not have a strong editorial voice and a track record of having a voice, then they don't have a leg to stand on in this media world that we live in.
So that like leads me to kind of current affairs. You know, right now, lots of, you know, when Trump did his immigration order, we had lots of companies in Silicon Valley come out and make a stand. You had Lyft donate to the ACLU. Uber kind of had to completely like do an about face. Were those companies acting in integrity in a journalistic sense, or was it just, you know, jumping on a marketing bandwagon?
I'll quickly answer that, and then I want to go back to the question of the revenue model, because I think we glossed over that, and I'd really like to hit on that a little bit. One, you know, everything moves so quickly in the space that we're in now, by tomorrow we're on to the next thing. It's just on to the next, and history is the thing that gets lost more quickly than anything else. And what I think that's interesting that we're seeing now is this conversation about Germany in the 30s and probably a lot of things that people haven't really talked about in a long time. I think Uber found itself having to backstep in order to be able to maintain its brand, and realizing that the people that work for them are the same immigrants that are being affected by this ban. So that's one thing. The other thing is that whether we're talking about online space or whether we're talking about legacy media like print, like television, there have not been really good, thoughtful discussions about what the revenue models are going to be. Now, I come out of television, so I come out of like old-time dinosaur television, and when I worked in television in the 90s, people told me it was a dinosaur back then. So it's still alive, it's still kicking. But even back then, there were conversations about the DVR and what was going to happen when nobody was going to watch advertising anymore, and how are we going to pay for our content? Television is doing okay. I don't know for how long it's going to be doing okay. And for the first time, there is more money in the digital space than there is in television. And so what begins to happen when the people who are producing the content are the people who are not generating the revenue? Specifically, and I'm guessing most of the people in the room understand this, most of the advertising money that appears in the digital space goes to two companies. And those companies are Google and Facebook. And how much content do those companies produce? Zero.
Yeah.
Zero. So the companies that are making the most money are the companies that aren't producing any content. And I have this conversation in my classroom, and I say to my students, do you watch television? And they all say no. And then I ask them the question, do you watch The Walking Dead? And they all say yes. It's like, yes, you are watching television, you're just not watching it in the screen in your living room, right? But they don't see it that way, right? And so they don't understand what has to go into the creation of that content. So what's happening on the television side, and what's also starting to happen on the digital side, is that, and I'm sure all of the people in this room, have gotten really good at not watching advertising. And everybody puts on the ad blockers, we use our DVRs, we do whatever we can not to engage with advertising. The problem is this advertising has been the primary funder of the content that we engage with. And if we don't want to look at advertising, then it all has to start to come out of our own pockets. And when we're talking about coming out of our own pockets, we're talking about you're paying for HBO Go, you're paying for Showtime, and even if you're a cord cutter, right, and you're no longer paying for cable or cord never and you never had cable, what you're going to end up paying will be at least what you were paying for cable, probably more than what you were paying for cable, and you will have far less content than what you had on cable. All of this is going on right now, and nobody wants to engage with it. The only person who has begun to talk about it is Barry Diller, and he did about it at the CES. And so he did it at an industry event.
Who is Barry Diller?
Barry Diller. He's the one who started the Fox Network. He worked at Paramount. He's a media mogul. But he has moved from television into the internet space. So he's the only one who's begun to talk about it. But one of the things that I'm really concerned about in all of these conversations that get sort of blown by in terms of the revenue model is how much it's going to cost all of us in order to be able to pay for the content that we're going to watch and engage with. And the other side of that is who doesn't get access to that content because they can't afford to pay for it.
Okay, so this is a good, in 10 minutes we'll go to audience Q&A, but I want you guys to think about, would you pay for news and how much would you pay for it in response to Mara's question? And actually I wanted to go on to, okay, go for it.
One real quick thing. What I'm proposing is that there is a third way. Okay, we've got a model that we've all been used to, that there's the advertising side of the house and the editorial side of the house, and there's a Chinese wall. And what I'm saying is that in this marketplace where we have Google and Facebook that are the distribution system for media, that a brand has a responsibility to step forward and they have to have a business model. And they're not selling an advertisement. They're providing information, and I'm not, it is journalism standards, but this isn't journalism that built our democracy, right? Neither is 80s
nostalgia.
So, you know, there's a real distinction here, and I think you have to put it in perspective. But the difference in the model, the third way, is that, and it's very democratic. If I, as a brand, whether I'm selling marshmallows or
Keith,
cars,
let's move on.
I'm willing to have a conversation with that brand, and so there's a value proposition to that.
So we definitely want you to think about that. Is there a third way? That's something like I hope questions come up about that, you know? So start to think about, would you pay for news? How much would you pay? And tell us why you pay. Start to think about, you know, is there a third way? And what does it look like to you? You know, can brands be a source of truth and facts for you or not? Could it never happen? I certainly think that there's almost like too much tenacity in the church and state question around editorial and advertising that actually is kind of, you know, vilifies people. Obviously we've got someone here who I'm gonna bring into the questions shortly. But I wanna get back to business models just quickly. You know, at the end of the day, the people paying for news right now are Google and Facebook essentially. And everyone, and you know, the Macedonians and the Brazilians are making money out of their fake news because someone's paying for it. You know, Facebook's selling that news, that advertising space to advertisers, they're making money, they're paying that back. You know, so there is definitely a kind of incentive right now to cover this trending content. And like, you know, how do you guys, on the kind of journalism side, and I want to ask Salima first, how do we cover Trump, and how do we differentiate between whether a Trump tweet is more important than another story? And, well, let's start with that.
So, fascinating. So, the role of journalist has historically been to bring information to the constituents about their governance and to make the governance accountable, okay? So what Trump has been doing in the last 2 years with his tweets is that he cut the middlemen. So he cut the media and he went directly to the audience. And now what we see, maybe not in Time, but in New York Times or in other media outlets, it's that they are following the tweets. And we have entered in this extremely sensational time. It's almost hysterical because there's a hysteria around it where every day you read headlines about the end of the world and you have to read like even more and more headlines about this is it. And this brings me back to a very interesting book from Guy Debord. Why am I saying it with the American accent?
That sounded really French to me.
Okay. So Guy Debord, who wrote the book The Society of the Spectacle, and in the 60s, and actually that led to the Parisian uprisings. So and where he denounces actually this whole society that's we don't have direct interactions between society members, but we interact through images and through the media. And right now, this Donald Trump for me epitomizes this idea of the spectacle. And then of course, the role of the media is to bring back to the front page the most important stories, and that's what Jonathan was saying, to share the maximum information and not say that Trump is necessarily a clown, but tell me more. It's good to denounce what he does and who he is and etc. But I want to hear more about how he's very successful at carrying out his messages and how and give me more arguments to counter this spectacle. And just to finish on that, what Guy Debord says is when there's a society of spectacle, you have to create a counter spectacle. Protesting the Women's March on Washington was an example of that. And the media, as Jonathan is describing, is certainly another form of that.
I love it. And I love this idea of counter spectacle. But you know, you made this point about Donald Trump is actually kind of an expert in his own right, and we often focus on the negative. And actually, that's also a question, and maybe you can take this, Jonathan, which is, you know, Trump's not always the bad guy in, you know, these people covering tweets. I mean, there was a conversation recently that the headline was "Go Nuclear," and it had nothing to do with what the reader might have expected that to be about. It was a kind of trick, you know, it was a tabloid trick, when really Trump was actually talking about going nuclear in an extreme bureaucracy sense. I mean, completely different to the original meaning of the words. Like, so to some degree, the media can also be a little bit kind of manipulative too. Shoot me down.
I won't shoot you down because media is such a general term.
Okay.
And I think, especially with the current administration, we are in an era where broad strokes are applied to too many things with little nuance. And that is a situation that we get into every single day with every talking point that's on every cable news commentary show. And I would all encourage you to watch I think it's Ted Koppel, Bill O'Reilly segment, where Ted Koppel exercises what he feels is the downfall of democracy by the turning of every single talking point of every politician into something that is divisive on the far left or the far right. It's a brilliant segment, and Ted Koppel's remarks could not echo my own sentiments more precisely. And I think that at the end of the day,
what I was gonna say is what Ted Koppel effectively says in that video, which we'll share in the newsletter tomorrow, because it's such a great video, is, you know, formats, media formats, have kind of distorted the truth. You know, it's a chasing of 24-hour news and reporting every tweet that kind of essentially sort of erodes the integrity of the industry. That's how I read it, at least. Mara's got a 2-second comment.
I mean, I think part of the issue with this has to do with taking our own responsibility as it relates to the information that we interact with. And obviously, those of us in media studies talk about this in terms of media literacy. And we think that kids should be learning this starting in, like, kindergarten. This is not something you need to learn as adults, but you need to understand what the media environment is and how information is presented to you and what the biases are of the various media forms that are presenting information to you. To that point, one quick stat to leave you with. When I talk to people in the industry, they would say, oh, millennials totally understand what native advertising is. They are able to differentiate between the content. It is so not true. When academics started looking at this information, what they found was 8%. 8% of people were able to determine that something was a piece of native advertising. More recently, researchers at Stanford looked at did studies with middle school kids, right? So these are the digital natives. These are the ones who grew up in this space. 20% were able to differentiate between journalism and advertising.
And it says sponsored content.
And it says sponsored content. It's not hidden. It's not hidden. It says sponsored content. It has the name of the advertiser. They still can't recognize that it's paid for.
And I think that there's a real responsibility that we have as, and I'm speaking for myself here, we have as journalists to differentiate and help also educate young people. And there's an, by the way, I'm not putting a plug for the News Literacy Project here, but I also am. Projects like the News Literacy Project, which I participate in, do an incredible job to go into high schools. We all have a responsibility in news to actually help young people, to pay it forward, to help differentiate what is news, what is fact, what is fiction. And this is not about partisan politics. This is not about the things that we see that we're like, oh, I disagree with this, but it might be factual. This is about the difference between the National Enquirer and the Onion and the people that are doing actual capital J journalism, and those people don't deserve to be brandished with the same brush and the same branding as our President Trump is regularly on a daily basis calling out people that work for national esteemed publications that are actually doing their best work to unearth the facts and unearth not alternative facts, but real facts and real journalism and the things that are actually going to separate us from what is fact and what is fiction. And there's no disparity between these two things when it really comes down to it.
I just wanted to say I'd like to get involved with that. I didn't know that existed, and I'm very interested in getting
What did you just say?
What did I just say?
Yeah, yeah.
It was important to teach. It was important to kind of generate media literacy amongst the youth.
Yeah. I'll give you the.
No.
Well, actually, I can talk to that. So, unfortunately, one of our guest speakers couldn't make it today, Claire Wardle, but that's what she's doing on firstdraftnews.com. Go and check it out. It's amazing. But she's creating whole packs around, you know, how to identify, you know, fake content, how to do verification, all that kind of stuff. And she couldn't make it tonight in the end, so we'll be at another event, so we'll keep having these discussions. But Selena's remembered her point,
yeah,
I think.
You.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. So actually, the big question is, who is going to take the responsibility of saying what is fact and what is fake news? So is it Google? Is it the search engines? Is it Facebook? They are very happy with the money, Google, but they're not happy with taking responsibility for discerning the good from the bad. And so I interviewed last week, I interviewed the head of the French publication Le Monde, the head of digital, and it was very interesting because
interesting.
They created this
embedded kind of fact checker in their search engine. And that's very easy to understand. And basically, people could go on the website and see what websites are trustworthy and those who are not. And actually, that's very interesting what you were mentioning, because a lot of people don't understand the difference between the equivalent of The Onion in France, the name is Le Gorafi, and so they didn't know that it was fake news. And basically, they started contacting Le Monde and saying, hey, is it true that, you know, like crazy stories? And Le Monde had to answer. So they started to create that. And another takeaway from Le Monde, if I may, it's that, and regarding the future of journalism, and I believe that it's headed towards more interactivity with the audience. So, for example, during the Charlie Hebdo attacks, they created some kind of interactive platform where people would ask questions live, and then you have journalists saying, we don't know if this is true, but give us a few minutes and we're going to check. And then also that educates the audience to learn how journalism is made, and basically they bring them in the behind the scenes and see that it takes effort, it takes time, we double check, we have three sources, and our job actually, going back to journalism school, it's three important things in journalism. It sums up in three things, which is verify, verify, and verify. So if you know how to do that, you can be a very good journalist.
Yeah, I love that. And I think that's, you know, leads nicely into this question of like, what will we pay for as readers? And maybe what we'll pay for is tools to better understand all the information coming at us, which is something I definitely see you doing at Time as well. But it's like, yeah, search engines. You might pay for a search engine that can help you kind of work out facts or dive deeper into a story. We've definitely seen like Vox, which helps you understand the story better, has been very successful pivoting editorially in that way. Similarly, it's gone now. Vox. No, I was going to say anonymous is an interesting one. So, when you had like national disasters like Hurricane Sandy and stuff, actually anonymous were the ones going in on the Twitter feed and trying to do the verification. Now, at first it started as a very noble endeavor and quickly got into fake news territory on its own. But that moment was very engaging of following a storm on Twitter. I've never done that before.
The Washington Post has the equivalent as well, and it's called factchecker.org, and it fact checks political news. So, and it's very funny because they have a little Pinocchio, and like, so you see a lot of Trump stories with four Pinocchios out of, yeah.
So one of the big themes that come out of this panel discussion is, telling better stories is a better way to convince people of facts. And facts are not powerful enough on their own. And actually, I'm going to throw this out to you guys now to start asking some questions. Okay. I was actually going to just quickly ask Kirk, who was on our Future of Storytelling panel a couple of months or last year. But you had a question, then we'll go to you.
Having been involved in both journalism and advertising over a number of years, I am more convinced that we have an advertising problem more than a news problem. Basically, news began to fall apart when advertising fell apart. More than half the newspaper industry has disappeared. Broadcast TV is on its way, as you pointed out. Cable's lunch is being eaten by streaming video, and the money is disappearing. I also challenge the notion that any of this advertising we don't pay for, because I know that Coca-Cola's $6 billion ad budget is built into every bottle now. Whether we can get them to lower the price because their ads don't work anymore, that's another question. But I would love to hear the discussion of the third way. How do we pay for all of this? Because we know it's important, and I spend a fortune on it, frankly, to answer your question. My journalism is my favorite charity, but I am not gonna be able to support it single-handed, and no reader can, really. At any rate, what happens?
Thank you. So the third way is a technology-enabled way. When you were distributing by paper and having trucks drive around, if somebody disagreed with a story or somebody wanted more information, they didn't go to the media company. Today, you can build a publication on top of automation systems that allow a company to operate that publication at scale and value the relationship that they have directly with the media consumer, reader, watcher, visitor, however you want to define that. So a media company builds an audience and has a secondary audience of advertisers. And that advertiser audience pays for building the general audience, and the general audience is more valuable to the advertiser based on number in the audience and the amount we know about the audience. And there's a middleman between the audience and the advertiser. If a respectable brand takes on the mission to create a publication, have video, well-written content, understands the needs of its audience, what they want to achieve, right? Entertainment, education, information, right? If they serve those needs and they define and understand their audience well, a company that sells Coke or an IBM mainframe, they know the value of how many sales they get. They know there's an addressable market. They know how many visitors they have. They know how many people of visitors become customers. So they can build a business model around that that is the direct conversation with the customer. And that also then enables the audience to have a dialogue and complain, right? So I won't use you anymore if you're not delivering.
So essentially, you know, a business can create a lot of content, generate the revenue for themselves to keep sustaining that content. And then the question remains, like, can audiences be persuaded that it's as valuable as journalism?
And I can project this in 30 years. You may have a coffee chain that gets involved in political aspects.
And does that mean that you know, these brands can donate to your favorite charity without corrupting that charity, i.e. journalism? If they can work out a way to make money, self-sustain, build their business, and convince everyone that they're authentic and telling good stories and win the trust of their audience, can they team up with traditional publishers like you? But Mara, I think
now you're getting at my last book, okay. Which is called Compassion Inc., and it's all about cause marketing, corporate social responsibility, and how companies should and should not tie into causes. Now, if a company legitimately has a relationship to a particular cause, that's fine. If it's built into their DNA, that I have no issue with that. It's when it becomes this one-shot deal of buying a candy bar and 5 cents go to goes to Egypt to pay for whatever. I mean, that's ridiculous, and that doesn't make any sense either for the brand, nor is it helpful or sustainable to the people that it's supposed to serve. That's a whole separate conversation. But as it relates to, and something we haven't really talked about at all in here, is the issue of data and how our data is being used and exploited, and our free labor is being used and exploited in order to perpetuate this content. So if you're talking about content being produced by an advertiser, it's not that they want you to come to their website. It's that they want you to distribute the website to your friends and your family. And so while Facebook has created a space that is supposedly a community, it's not a community, it's a platform to sell advertising. As your phone is an advertising medium, the same way your television set was an advertising medium. And so part of this conversation, I feel, really has to be about, you know, where and how is our data being used in relationship to the perpetuation and dissemination of this content? And, you know, where are we being asked to play a part in the selling of this content for the Coca-Colas and the Pepsis and so on?
Yeah, and if anyone wants to read up on Mara's point, you should check out Slavoj Zizek. There's a video on YouTube about how, you know, society ends up kind of justifying everything through, you know, all it basically kind of pays, you pay to get rid of your guilt by buying your fair trade coffee and stuff like that. So it's a video worth watching. Anyway, we've got a question from this nice lady over here.
Hi, my name's Anu Singh. I have a question about liberal news specifically. There is, and you guys have touched on this question. There is a liberal bias in some liberal media outlets, and they don't give fake news, but they pick and choose which facts to tell and which stories to tell that promote a specific viewpoint. And they did this before the election with regard to, there were people saying that Trump has a better chance of winning than people were saying, but they didn't listen to those people, or when they were on TV, they literally laughed at them. So, and then you would think that liberal media would have learned their lesson with Trump's win, but it doesn't seem like they have, because recently Nordstrom, when Trump tweeted about Nordstrom, the media said, well, Nordstrom's stock went up, and it was, you know, a lot of the media jumped on this. Talk shows and all media outlets, they jumped on this saying that, you know, Nordstrom's stock went up, implying that it had to do with Trump's tweet. But in fact, the stocks for multiple department stores went up that day.
So what's the question exactly?
So my question is that why? Why hasn't liberal news learned its lesson? Still feeding us the facts that conveniently, I mean, and you guys have touched on this in many ways for why the revenue model and things like that, but I'm still like, and what can we do to fix that? And then also just a related question is, how do you tell stories? In stories, there is inherent bias in stories because you're picking certain facts and thoughts that promote a specific story, viewpoint, but how do you do that and also give enough context and give all the facts necessary to educate people?
That's a great question. Can we start with that one? About how do we create the meta context for half of this stuff?
Yeah, I totally agree. There's no such thing as no bias. And just for sake of clarity, there are different types of pieces in a newspaper, and you have the opinion pieces. And it's true that in a lot of outlets, you see features that are supposed to be more fair, that have some color that they shouldn't, maybe. And then you have the AP style of writing, which is the most factual and technical, right? So we're talking about features here, you know, or kind of fair reporting. So the basis is to give a voice to the two opposing parties, and to ask the question in a, you know, the most neutral tone possible. But it's true that it's impossible to choose an angle without a bias. So you're going there, and that's the beauty of it, because if it was the case, maybe we can robotize this industry in the future, and that's the human factor. So that's what I can say as a journalist.
Let's go to the next question.
Okay. I would contend, I'd be interested to know what the panel thinks, that the cause of fake news is human behavior. It's not technology, it's human behavior, right? That having worked at legacy media companies myself, they were built for another time when people cared about facts and people cared about reason, right? But I think that audience has moved on. The same way that, I mean, to your point, you know, several years ago, the number one source of news for college students was The Daily Show, right? And The Onion, in many ways, The Onion is only funny because of what lies under it, right? It's not just random headlines. And I would contend that today the most powerful media outlet against the Trump administration is Saturday Night Live, right? Because again, they get to the essence of the problem, but they also present it in a way that people actually pay attention to it. So does the entire news media format, print, you know, television, all that, need to be completely reworked and get away from the, you know, the fact rational approach, because I don't think people care.
One thing I would say is that this is not liberal versus conservative, right? This is political party versus political party, because the essence of liberalism and how that rose and how we created democracy is very different than I think what we're talking about that's going on in the media right now. And the education, it's not just media literacy, it's understanding a much broader context of living in a society. So I think the education is the key question. I'd come back to that.
Just,
Well, you know, part of this gets tied into this blurring of the line between advertising and journalistic content. And the thing that drives advertising is emotion. And the two emotions that drive advertising is awe and anger. So think about when you decide to share something. It's either because you were really pissed off about something, or maybe it made you really happy and you wanted to share something that's really funny with your friends. Or as something that you were really surprised about until you shared it. And so it's those ideas that have become the clickbait, right? Or what one journalist called whorebait, and that is what is driving the content. And so whether it becomes something that's advertising or it becomes what ultimately becomes journalists, and I think this is actually a really interesting conversation that I haven't heard discussed, is the importance of headlines, right? And the fact that headlines are never written by the reporter, right? And the headlines are the things that are getting people to engage with the content. Now, I don't know. I think we'd have a conversation as to whether or not people don't want real facts and whether or not they don't want real journalism. I would argue that people do, and I think we're seeing people read an awful lot, and I think that they don't get the full benefit of SNL. But, you know, there is certainly plenty of people that are getting their content from, and actually, interestingly enough, Colbert has started, his ratings are starting to increase because he's being a lot more political.
I would say that I can speak specifically to Time in saying that we have had a couple of our best months ever since the election. And there is, and it's not about audience. I think that it underscores the importance of the fact that we need to show up every day prepared to do our jobs. We need to prepare every day to figure out how we are going to combat something that is directly targeting our credibility. And when we're painted with a broad stroke of the dishonest media, I take personal offense to that. I wake up every single day and I say, I am being targeted as the dishonest media. I am going to do everything that I can to show that I am displaying the facts. And I'm going to let you, every single one of you, decide what you should decide about what is being done in this administration. And I refuse to be lumped in with everyone. And we all have made mistakes. We are human beings. We all understand the human condition. We all understand what it means to care for somebody who we might not necessarily agree with, but we understand we may have differences. But you know what? We're going to do our damn best to make sure that we're reporting on it honestly and fairly. And we're going to, and I would challenge anybody to say that Time has not done an excellent job of that. And watching today's press conference, and I would please encourage you to go home and watch what happened this afternoon with this press conference, if you have not seen it already. You will see it play out on Saturday Night Live. And I would disagree with you to say that a lot of America is getting their news from the late night shows. I do think a portion of us are getting entertainment from that, but I disagree. And I think that hopefully most of us, and I hope and I will inspire most of you to try and find your facts from elsewhere than the Stephen Colberts and the John Olivers, who, by the way, have a tremendous staff of people who are so talented at helping us understand this in an entertaining and in both enlightening way that have opened my eyes to ways that I should be covering what's happening in the vernacular.
Yeah, I think we've got more questions. But yeah, thanks for that. I mean, one thing is interesting is like when you love news, you really love news, and actually you will digest every possible version of it, and like we just need news gifts now. That's a startup idea.
Okay, yes, good evening. My question is for the gentleman from Time and from Mara. I'm born and raised here in New York City, and I just returned to New York after 14 years living abroad. I was in London for 11 years and 3 years in Berlin. And as an American, the thing that you see acutely in Americans living abroad and foreigners who come to live here, they see what's the thing that they see most about American media is the feeble level of international news coverage. My question to you is, who bears greatest responsibility to to raise the literacy of Americans with regards to international news, especially in the context of where the times that we're living. We were already in a bubble. This bubble is being actually reinforced. It's almost like triple pain now, you know, with argon gas between each pain. What's going to happen in 4 years, or God forbid, 8 years, if we're living in a society, in a country that is so hyper-focused on what's happening in Washington, D.C., and how it relates to Americans? And so the question, I mean, what I find really, really interesting about that is we are the country that has successfully exported its culture to every corner of the globe through media, through all forms of media. And if we're thinking that our media was prolific in the 60s and 70s, no, it's now it's the most prolific. Through Facebook, through Google, Snapchat, it's all American. Virtually all of it, it's being pushed out to the rest of the world. So if we're producing this much content to the rest of the world, how much of it is coming back to us? That's my question.
So who bears the responsibility?
Yeah, who bears the greatest responsibility?
Thank you. Thank you for putting that cross upon me. What I can say is that, I'll answer this question in two ways. First, I think that we have a responsibility to report on the issues that the brunt of our audience wants to pay attention to. I will say that that is, you know, I, as Time Video, will skew that away from entertainment coverage because I know that that's what our audience will gravitate toward. I specifically skew our content away from that because I know that we have a responsibility to do one better than that. And fortunately, as a part of Time Incorporated, we have 28 publications that cover an incredible depth and breadth of content. So the producers that report to me, the people that I actually control their day-to-day operations, I have a responsibility to our audience to provide a diverse breadth of content over everything that we cover. Specifically to what I think is one of the most important stories that we have an obligation to cover this year, which is the refugee crisis, which is what is happening. And this ties into the travel ban, this ties into the executive orders that have been, this is all interconnected. Everything that we're doing is interconnected. We are one global species, we are one community. And specifically to Time's coverage, we are devoting, I have had a producer who has been abroad since the second week of December, who is working on what I hope will turn into a feature-length documentary, and I would encourage every single one of you to look up the project called Finding Home. We followed four refugee families that have fled from Syria this year, who have now found, they're trying to find refugee status in countries, and I'm not gonna speak directly to those families because these conversations with their host countries could potentially be impacted by that. But these were four mothers who were 9 months pregnant when they crossed the border from Syria into Turkey, and we filmed all four childbirths. And we've devoted a tremendous amount of resources to actually telling that story of what does it mean to be a refugee in an era where we've seen the largest human migration in any of our lifetimes. And what does it actually mean to us? What does it mean to be a refugee? And what does it mean to be actually finding something greater? So we're devoting a tremendous amount of resources to actually telling that story. And this year specifically, you're going to see that manifest on social media. We're finding home on Instagram. We're getting the support of Instagram and also refugee organizations that are supporting UNHCR, the Pulitzer Center for Crisis Reporting. We're getting a tremendous amount of support from other agencies that are actually supporting this. So this is one portion, one major portion of what we're doing to cover stories outside of the domestic US news angle. But there are other things that we're covering other than Trump. It's like, this is not just about the White House administration.
And you know, what's under what you just said is actually Time Magazine is operating in a very collaborative capacity with Instagram, with all these other organizations. So they're trying to kind of share the burden of responsibility on that particular topic. A real quick answer, because we got like four more questions.
I'm gonna make it really quick.
And it's a really complex question. I think there's a couple of places you can look. One is education, and our educational system has been created so that people, that kids are being tested not about facts and certainly don't care about international, that's one. Two, the amount of money that is being taken out of journalism, and so they've had to find, they have to cut, and one of the first things that usually gets cut is the international bureaus. I think the other part of it goes to your point, which is the the entertainmentization of news, which started in the 1970s. One of the things that I really like to do in the classroom is try and bring ideas from outside the United States. Like a fundamental thing, in Sweden, children's advertising is not allowed for kids under 12. Imagine what that would do to our country if we couldn't advertise to kids under 12.
So government needs to bear some of the burden. All right, just give me a quick like energy level squeal. Are you doing well, badly? Cool, all right. Okay, cool, next question.
Hi, I have a question about news consuming channels, about the future of news consuming channel, because all I hear is that the paper is dead, the desktop web is dead, the native apps are dead. I heard that Outbrain think that Facebook bots will be the future, but I would love to hear your opinion about what is the future of news consuming channels.
There's a very recent piece on, development on the publishing website Medium that publishes, blogging, and it was founded by one of the founders of Twitter. And so his model is evolving right now, and that's why it's interesting. so he said that the landscape of blogging was disastrous, and he wanted to solve that problem. And he said that the idea was to promote quality pieces based on how long people would read them versus how many clicks they would gather. And but now his model is not working. They're laying off a lot of people, and it's not dead, but he's evolving towards subscription model. And we know that the New York Times right now is doing great with subscriptions, and maybe that's where we're headed, and that's an option. But I don't believe that there's going to be anything dying anytime soon. That's we've been thinking about that since 1450 and the invention of the press, and then with the video and photography. And but we see that every medium becomes better at what they do. Look at photography now. I mean, with Instagram, it's amazing. Look at video, look at reading. I mean, I'm very optimistic. So
one area that I'd say to take a look at is net neutrality. And we're having that decimated right now, but the ability for the small voice to get out and be a channel of one. I mean, that was the vision of the internet, and that's going away, and I think that's sad.
And actually, if you want to just experience like chatbot delivered news, check out the Quartz app. And in the end, you think this is just a very laborious way of reading the headlines, but it's worth checking out. Okay, question over here.
Hello, everyone. My name is Nelson Igunma. So, Salima, you were speaking earlier using the Charlie Hebdo attacks as an example of, I don't know whether there's a Charlie Hebdo or a magazine in Paris that was interacting with readers during the attacks and answering questions. So I had the opportunity to attend a previous panel last year about crowdsourcing, and so what you were talking about seemed to be an evolution of that, where we're going with crowdsourcing from journalists who are working on a project, have a question, are going out to readers and asking for information and support, to now where journalists, are taking questions from readers, I assume in real time, and are kind of bear the responsibility of answering accurately and as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. But this is the first time that I've ever heard of that, and it's interesting that it happened with a French publication. This goes to the rest of the panel. Just thinking about the full range of publications here, I don't know if I would think of a legacy institution like, you know, the New York Times or Time taking that on. And that's something that I have a problem with, and I feel like that's something that goes to larger issues with access to media, you know, to perceptions that people of different backgrounds from different demographics have with the perceptions they have of certain publications. So I want to get a sense, like, what does it take for, you know, an esteemed publication, a prestige publication, you know, a legacy publication, whatever you want to call it, to actually engage with readers on such a deep level like that, like actually reaching out to them directly in the way that this publication did in France?
Okay, so the question is like, what do publications need to do to engage readers directly, or under what guise?
Yeah. It's true, it's very surprising that it comes from France because there's a certain rigidity to everything French. But actually, this director of this program, he's French-Lebanese, and he's very young. So I think that played a part. He's also trained at the Nieman Lab in Harvard. He did part of his training here. But from what I saw in my interview with him, it's that it comes from a place of humility, you know, to say, I want to listen to my audience and I want to hear their question and value it and also work together to find the truth. And so I really, you know, appreciated that when I interviewed him. And then for the US, I don't know.
So speaking specifically to legacy, the beautiful thing that's happened in the last 15 years is that major media publications are on the internet. And you can Google who works for people. And it's not difficult to figure out that Jonathan Woods works for Time Magazine. If you Google my name, you can find my cell phone on the internet. It's not that hard. Like, we are accessible, and the beauty of working in 2017 in media publishing is that anybody that actually has the inherent, innate interest in reaching out to somebody at a publication, you can find us, and we will respond to you if you have a valid critique, criticism, or input. And like I said, I get a lot of garbage that comes across my brow every single day about,
and it's 80s nostalgia.
80s nostalgia. And it's not going to register on my radar. But the minute I see something that is valid and in the vernacular and it is about the conversation that I'm having right now, I will respond to that. And we are accessible. And we have people that are reading feedback at time.com. It comes to my inbox regularly, the critiques that we're getting from, I mean, people that are like, I can't watch video on my iPhone. I am getting those emails in my inbox. So please write to us. Please reach out to us. And don't think that your critiques, your comments, your criticisms, your input are falling on deaf ears, because we are actually watching that. We have people staffed to address those things. So don't think that you are reaching out to, you know, throwing spaghetti at the wall and hoping that it hits something. Like, you're actually, write the feedback at time.com and you will get a response. And you may even get a response from me, if it's especially regarding video viewership on our website.
Yeah, which is a hopeful message, right? Basically, journalists are listening, the media is listening, it's not so cut off as we might assume. Okay, we got last question, unfortunately, and actually it's the lady behind you. No, it's you.
Oh, it's me.
With the microphone.
Oh, so I'm going to try to simplify this as much as possible, but I think it's something that's been touched on tonight, and it has to do with the various layers of media and bubbles between conservatives and liberals and Democrats and Republicans, and how we break down those walls between people, and how, for instance, my brother reads Breitbart, I read the New York Times. I don't think I'm better because
that must
of
be
it.
A fun thing.
Yeah, you're telling me. But how do we as, I'm not in media, unfortunately, but how do we communicate with people who are on other side and in a different side than we're on?
Okay, that was an awesome question to end on. So yeah, how do all four of you propose we communicate with the other side?
My dad votes a straight Republican ticket. my mom votes Democrat. I live in a split household, and I think that that's one of the greatest things that has ever happened to me. We are somehow able to have civil conversations, and I think that it's all about understanding that there is compromise to be had, and we might disagree on a lot of issues, but I think that compromise is the thing that we have to start pushing for in our society, in our families, in our friendships, in our relationships with our coworkers. We don't have to agree on things. We do not have to agree on things, but we have to be willing to accept alternate viewpoints that are in stark contrast to one another. And if we can't do that, we're not going to be able to find middle ground. And I think that I've I was born in 1982. I've never lived in a time that is in such stark contrast and so divisive as the time that we're in now. I'm gonna end it there. We've got a lot of brilliant minds here, but that's where I'm at.
Thanks. I have never been as interested as learning and listening to the other side. Actually, at the UN, I interviewed one of the Nobel Prizes from last year, who comes from Tunisia, and I said, how would you engage with Islamists? Because, not the super bad ones, but the normal ones who are in some governments. She said listening. And I was amazed because that was never an option. And since then, I developed that muscle and I'm trying to stretch it and to learn and to even read Breitbart just to see how it looks like and to be called a leftist. And that was weird, but it was an interesting experience. And I feel that I'm kind of growing in a way.
I would say listening and having a conversation, and trying to get where the other person's coming from. In my closed little Facebook world, I moderate a debate, and it's people that I've picked up along my lifetime, and the range of a guy from eighth grade who lives in Milwaukee is very hardcore Republican. I've learned out of the experience, I'm a liberal Republican. I'm a very liberal Republican, probably more liberal than most Democrats, but I'm a Republican in other parts of the way I view the world. So I think that you have to accept that there is no, it's not one and two or A or B. It's a variety of voices, and so listening is really the key.
So we got compromise, listening, debate.
I would also say find out what his fears are. Because what I've found in the classroom is the day after the election, and I teach at CUNY, I teach at CUNY at Queens, which is the most diverse county in the United States. There are over 47, maybe 50 different languages spoken on our campus. Most are first generation or people of color. So these are people who really, a lot of them are afraid about what is going to happen. I had one student say to me that she started carrying a knife in her boot the day after the election started. There was also somebody in my class who said, not everybody in this room voted for Clinton. My secretary voted for Trump. And in talking to her, she is somebody who is probably making $30,000 or $40,000 a year, doesn't see an opportunity to be making a whole lot more money. She heard somebody who was going to say, he's gonna make it better. And I think in listening, I think it's heart. I think it's not just listening to head. I mean, journalism, you gotta listen to head. When you're talking to people about what their fears are, you gotta listen to their heart. And that's what we got to do. What we're talking about, and this is actually something that I posted online, what we're fighting for now is open minds and open hearts.
Thank you.
You could say compassion. So compromise, listening, debate, compassion. Anyway, with that, can you give a warm round of applause to our panel here? Thank you so much, all of you, for your considerate answers. Thank you guys for all your questions. We're all gonna stick around, so you can keep asking people, keep the conversation going. And yeah, we've got more beer and wine and pizza. Thanks. Look forward to seeing you again soon.
Thank you.